Good morning, everyone. Welcome to 8:32. Glad you're here this morning on the hazy Utah morning. The fire smoke is working its way in, covering things up, but we're so glad you're here this morning. We also want to welcome those that are joining us online, and glad you're with us this morning, and just trust that you'll have a wonderful time as we worship together. Let's begin our service with prayer. God, it's good to be in your house this morning. Thank you for life and health and the ability that we have to come and be here and to worship you and serve you and honor you. We pray that everything that is said and done this morning and our voices lifted to you in praise, may it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to share a scripture verse this morning from Ezekiel chapter 34, verse 26, and it says, I will bless my people and their homes around my holy hill, and in the proper season I will send the showers they need. There will be showers of blessing. We're going to sing about that on our first song. Let's stand and sing together, Showers of Blessings. Would you turn to someone and say, I'm glad you're here this morning.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. I just have a couple of announcements before we turn to prayer. We have the deacon nominations. They are ending this next Sunday, so you have one more week. There are deacon nomination forms over here on that small table. So be praying this week and make sure you get those nominations in by this Sunday. You can turn those in into the offering plate. Also, Last month, you prayed for me when I went to Wyoming with only 7 students. Now I'm going this week with 21 students to Big Canyon. So we would appreciate your prayers. Pray for the students as they go to camp. I pray that they would experience the Lord and be impacted by it. And then finally, our last announcement is today after church, right in this room, Joy Fellowship will be having a patriotic picnic and sing-along. So that is for 50-year-olds and older. They're just older youth. So that's what Joy stands for, if you don't know. And so join them today after church, and it'll be a great time together. So just a couple of updates before we turn to prayer. Disaster Relief, their team is returning today, so we'll be praying for safe travel and pray that the Lord would continue to use their efforts and work that they did. And we also have an update on Terry Thurman. So Terry is currently in the ICU with COVID, and if you've been seeing the updates via email, this morning we can report that it's looking like he's improving a bit, so that's very good. So we're going to continue praying for him today, as well as Donna Lawrence, who's in the same household as the Thurmans. So Chris and Amber Lawrence are Terry's kids, and so Chris's mother, Donna Lawrence, is also in the hospital, so we're going to be praying for her as well. Michelle Bird and all their family, Terry's family, thank you very much for the prayers that you've been offering up on their behalf. Please continue to do so. I'm not quite out of the woods. So as we think about that, let's pray to the Lord now for their family. Father, you are in control. Nothing surprises you. So Father, even though we may worry, Father, maybe we have anxiety, I pray that you would help us to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are good, that you are in control, that you know all things. Father, we pray for the Thurman family, for the Lawrence family. We pray that you would continue to provide healing. We pray that you would provide comfort to the families during this time, endurance as they are taking shifts and staying up almost constantly. So, Father, I pray for strength for them. Father, we pray that you would relieve any pain today, that the healing would go quick, that it would be clear that you are working. Father, we will give you glory regardless. Father, we pray for safety as the disaster relief team returns. Thank you for how you use them. I pray that as they return and as they go out again, that you would continue to raise up people that would be a part of that team, because it's desperately needed as we have members that are growing a bit older and need to be relieved of that. So, Father, we pray for that you would raise up workers in that area. As we continue in worship, I pray that you would bless this time together, that you'd be glorified, and that we would lift you up alone. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Isn't the Christian family wonderful? Thinking about the prayers for Terry and Debbie Thurman, I was talking to my Christian pastor friend in Stevensville, Montana yesterday, quite a long ways away from here. And before we hung up, we just stopped and prayed for Debbie and Terry. And I was thinking, those prayers, probably for them, are all over the world. And we don't even know some people we're praying for, but God knows them. And that's an exciting thing, that he cares and that we can all share together and pray for one another. An exciting thing. Let's sing a chorus this morning, Great and Mighty. The Lord our God, great and mighty is He. Great and mighty is the Lord our God, great and mighty is He. Lift up your banner, let the anthems ring, praises to our King. Great and mighty is the Lord our God, great and mighty is He. And mighty up your banner, let the anthems ring. Praises to our King. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Take the name of Jesus with you. My bad. I had an extra verse in there and the piano accompaniment it only had three. So anyway, my fault. Let's stand together as we sing our last chorus, and I love this one. There's something about that name. Just let these words just soak into you as we sing it together. Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after heaven and earth. sing it again. And Jesus, 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 there's just something. Praise your name this morning. We thank you for your wonderful name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Everybody's sitting in the back there. Turn with me this morning to Exodus chapter 19. Exodus chapter 19. There's just something about that name. I love that song. Have been singing that song since I was a young fella. And it just remains a sweet song to me. I remember being in the youth choir and being taught to sing not Jesus, but Jesus. And anyway, there's just something about that name. Well, I remember quite clearly preparing to pop that all-important question to Valerie. How should I do it? What should I say? How will she respond? And finally, that moment came, and I bravely asked the question. Honey, I've waited so long to ask you this. What do you like better, my handsome face or my muscular body? And her response, your sense of humor. In all seriousness, so I remember that other question too. And I'm grateful that when I asked that other question that she didn't think I was joking at that time. But there was a conversation that I remember in our relationship way back, well, not way back, but that preceded me asking Valerie to marry me. And it might be a question that's referred to in these days as DTR. You ever heard that phrase, DTR? It stands now for defining the relationship. And I don't know that that was a thing back then, but I remember a conversation when we defined the relationship. And our conversation was something like this. So, where are we headed? You know, where are we exactly? Are we on the same page? And needless to say, the answer that we came up with, our kids are very happy with today. But here's the thing. As I was preparing for this message, I found it interesting that there was a pastor in Massachusetts by the name of Jonathan Romig, and he referred to this moment in Exodus 19 as DTR moment, the defining the relationship moment between God and His people. And I really kind of like that. It gave perspective to this moment. Because God is defining, and he's initiating that as he defines the relationship here in Exodus chapter 19. You see, God has saved the Israelites physically. He has brought them out of Egypt. They have been enslaved for 400 years. So one might say that all that time, they're more Egyptian than they are Israelite, right? I mean, who knows what all they have brought into their own lives because they've been there for 400 years. So God will need to not only introduce himself to them, but he will also have to show this people how to be in a relationship with him. And so what I want to do this morning is I want to ask four questions, and then we're going to look at Exodus 19 and allow the text to answer those questions. Question number one, why are the Israelites at this mountain? Why are the Israelites at this mountain? And here's the answer. The Israelites have come full circle because of the promise of God, because God had promised it. Now, I want to remind you of where we've been of late, and Pastor Justin preached a couple of very good messages, and I want to just sort of go back through where we've been. The Israelites have now crossed through the Red Sea, and God parted the waters, and they came right through. Now, I think that I have a clip of that. Watch the blue waters just part right here. How did that get in there? I don't know how that happened.
And does. Touchdown.
But, you know, I don't know how it got in there, but did you see the blue waters just part? And did you see him just march right through? So that's what Israel did. They just marched right on through, and they entered into the wilderness of Shur. And then once they got there, they became unsure because there was no water. And there was no water found for 3 days. And then when they did find water, they found the bitter waters of Marah. And so what did they do? They began to murmur and they began to complain because they were Baptist. Excuse me, I didn't mean to say that. Because they were thirsty. And the people not only were thirsty, but God provided them water. And he provided them sweet water. And then you fast forward, and when the people were hungry, God fed them manna. And he would continue to provide that manna for 40 years. And so time and time again, what we need to understand is that God not only keeps his promises, but he also provides for the Israelites in the desert. It's not always how they want him to, or when they want him to, or the way they want him to, but God is always keeping his promises, and he is always providing. And so now as we arrive at the mountain of God, here's the thing that we have to remember. This is not the first time that we have been to this mountain in Exodus. Now, in this series of messages, all the way back on April 11th when we started in Exodus, we began in Exodus 19. And we looked at the first 8 verses, and then the next week we backed up to chapter 1. And there was a method to that madness. When we walked through Exodus chapter 1, 2, and we came to chapter 3, we found in verse number 12 that God appeared to Moses in a burning bush, and he promised that he would bring Moses along with the Israelites back to this mountain. And the text says, he answered, I will certainly be with you, and this will be a sign to you that I am the one who sent you. When you bring the people out of Egypt, you all will worship God at this mountain. And so here we are. We have come full circle. Promise made, promise kept. And so God called to Moses from the mountain, and he said, come up and listen to what you must tell the Israelites in verse number 3. And he reminded Moses of all that he had done to bring Israel out of Egypt in verse number 4. And then he reminds Moses of what he wants to do. Now let me remind you of what was said in the past to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verse 2. God said, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. So with that in mind, and I could quote other verses like it, we come to Exodus 19, 5 and 6, and I want you to listen to what it says. Now if you will carefully listen to me and keep my covenant, you will be my own possession out of all the peoples, although the whole earth is mine, and you will be my kingdom of priests and my holy nation. These are the words that you are to say to the Israelites. God speaking to Moses, telling him what he's going to say to his people. And God says here, hey, the whole earth is mine, but this people, the Israelites, you are a special people. You are my people. And so this is a key moment in that DTR, in that defining the relationship. And so when Valerie and I had our conversation, I started out by saying, now, Valerie, this is the way it's going to be. How many of you believe that's the way it went? I can tell you right now that's not the way it went. We were just two people, a man and a woman, created by God, different but equal. And there, standing before each other, we had a conversation about pursuing God together, and if he willed it, pursuing marriage together, and the rest is history. And so as God stands before Moses here, and he tells Moses what to say to Israel, I want to make a clear distinction. This is not a man standing before Moses. This is not a man standing before Israel. It's not a man standing before his prospective bride. It is a holy God standing before a man, Moses, and before an unholy people, Israel. He is creator. He is deliverer. He is rescuer. He is promise keeper. He is God. He is the God of Israel. And he says, these are the conditions. This is what the conditions of our relationship will be. So hear me. This is God to man. This is DTR. This is God defining the relationship. And by the way, throughout history, and as clearly seen in the days we're living in, mankind keeps on trying to define his relationship with God. In other words, mankind tries to say, I can come to God on my own terms. Or I can fashion God into a God that I'm comfortable with and that I like and can be exactly who I want him to be. And God reminds us here, and we see it in this text, that he is the definer. And by the way, that's awesome because he's better. He's good, he's holy, and he is a promise keeper, even when we fail to keep our own promises. And so God is not wanting Israel to return to Egypt, but instead he brought them out so that he could set them apart in this world as his own treasured possession. And he wants to transform this people into a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. You might say it this way, a light to the nations. Don't miss that. God wants to bring this people out so that the people of the world might come to know him through this special people. And so God himself wants to be made known. And he is a missionary God. That's why he sent his son Jesus. And so by bringing Israel out of slavery, by bringing Moses back to this mountain, by calling Moses to come up with and meet with him, to tell him what to say to the people, God is revealing how much he wants his people to know him, to walk with him, to be changed by him, so that they may be used for his purposes and his plans in the world. And there is an individual aspect of it. Moses is standing before God. But there is also a community aspect where God wants Israel to be a light to the nations. And it's a very important thing to remember here in just a moment, because you may be thinking, Pastor Jason, that's great for Israel, but what does that have to do with us? What, I mean, does it make a difference here sitting on a Sunday morning to me and to you? And the reality is, it makes all the difference. You see, in the same way that God wanted to do that through Israel, God wants us to know him, to walk with him, to be changed by him, to be set apart, to be used in this world, to make him known and to be a light to the nations. And there is an individual responsibility. You and I have an individual responsibility of obedience in that area. And then there is a community aspect where the church together is on mission to fulfill the Great Commission. And all of that is seen clearly here in that first question, because Israel has come full circle back to this place because God promised. This is what God said he would do, and he had a plan for his people. Question number two, why was it important for the Israelites to meet with God, to meet with him? Answer number two, the Israelites meet with God in order to hear from God. Now, I could ask that question, why was it important for Israel to meet with God? And we could say, in order to be obedient, you know, because God told Moses, you'll come back to this place. You could say it's so that they will keep their word, because time and time again they said that they wanted to go into the wilderness to worship God. You might say that it's because God had promised and he brought them to the mountain. We just talked about that, and that's true. But while they are there, and while they are meeting with God, what's happening? What is it all about? And when we get to the heart of it, what we see is that the Israelites desperately needed to meet with God so that they could hear from God. They had come this far because God met with Moses and God led them to meet with him on the mountain. But this is that DTR. This is where God is going to show them who he is, who they are, and how they are to live in a relationship with him. And so they needed to hear it. Who had been the leader up until this point? Well, Moses had been, and Aaron with him. But in Exodus 19:9, it says, "The Lord said to Moses, 'I'm going to come to you in a dense cloud so that the people will hear when I speak with you and will always believe you.'" And so God is going to show his great power, and they will see and they will hear and they will believe that Moses is speaking to them on God's behalf. Now, I want to back up a step and I want us to see something. Moses came down, he summoned the elders, he set before them all that God had commanded in verse 7. And then having heard that, in verse number 8, the people say this, "We will do all that the Lord has spoken." So Moses says, this is what you're to do. They say, "We will do all that the Lord has spoken." They heard and they listened and they committed to obey. Now we'll find out later that they don't always do a very good job at that, right? You know, when you leave this building today, it is unlikely that God will speak to you through a burning bush. Now, it's possible you may encounter a burning bush as hot as it is in Utah today. But I don't think you'll encounter one that doesn't burn up. And it's unlikely that God will speak to you through a bush. But I want to say this today. We can all hear from God today. Everybody here, we can all hear from God today. He has given us his word right here. He has given us the Bible, and we can gather around it. We can read it. We don't have to wait for Moses to come down from the mountain and speak to us. Now, you're here, and God's word is being preached, and praise God, every time you come to Canyon Church, God's word is going to be preached, and God uses preachers, and God uses teachers. That's why he calls them and gifts them. But bottom line is, listen, you don't have to wait for Pastor Jason or Pastor Justin or Pastor Moses or Pastor Aaron or even Pastor Big Britches. You can open up your Bible and you can hear from the God of heaven. You can open up your Bible, and if Christ lives in you, if you've been saved by the grace of God, his Spirit is in you, and as you read this living, active word, he will guide you and teach you. He will speak to you through his word. And I know it's 8:30 in the morning. I know it's early, but that's good news, isn't it? That you can hear from God. Why is it important that we meet with God? It's important for us to meet with him because just like Israel, we desperately need to hear from God. We hear what other people have to say. We hear what the current news says. We can see current events. We can hear the perspective of the world in our house. We can hear from our kids. We can hear from our spouse. We can hear from a lot of folks who love to hear themselves talk. We can even hear from ourselves, our thoughts, our emotions, interpreting our circumstances. But here's the question. Are we hearing from God? Remember what we learned on Father's Day. If we don't consider Jesus, if our eyes aren't fixed on him, we will grow weary. We will lose heart. We have to keep our eyes on the ball. And so are we hearing from him? Are we following him? You know, it's really hard for us to say that we are followers of Christ with a straight face if we're not meeting with him so that we might hear from him. Are we meeting with him? Are we hearing from him? God called Israel into a unique and awesome relationship with himself because he wanted them to be set apart so that they might be a light to the nations, so that he might be made known. And God has called us into a unique relationship with Him, whereby Christ lives in us, we are His church, and we are to make Him known. But Houston, we have a problem. Question number three. Why did the Israelites need to wash their clothes? Short answer to that is they were dirty. But here's a better, more polished answer. Answer three. The Israelites were to wash their clothes because God revealed their filth. Isn't it interesting that just as quick as the people say, "We will do all that you say," that God calls Moses back up the mountain and He tells them to go down and tell the people that they need to go to the laundromat. To use Pastor Justin's words from last week, maybe Moses said, "You stinketh." They were dirty. In Exodus 19:10 says, "And the Lord told Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. They must wash their clothes and be prepared by the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people." You see it? They must wash their clothes. Have you ever found yourself face to face with maybe one of your children or your grandchildren, or maybe your dog or your cat or your pet pig, whatever it may be, all right? And they're standing there at the door filthy. I can envision in my mind my two dogs standing at the sliding door, and you'll know it's been a while given our weather in Utah, but I can picture them standing there wanting to come back in the house, and their feet are just muddy, just dripping mud, nasty. What are you going to do? You know, behind you, your clean floors and maybe your white carpet, whatever. I mean, clean. And here they are in all their filth. If you can picture that in your mind, whether it's just you imagining my situation or you have your own picture, that's Israel standing before God. That is what we're talking about right here. And you see, on one hand, there's the external. There's that which is easy to see. The Israelites have been out in the wilderness. They've been in the desert. And you don't get out in the desert and walk around in all that dirt and dust and that dry place without getting dirty. So they're dirty physically, externally. But there is a bigger issue that we are going to begin to learn about. And the external dust really just symbolizes the internal filth of sin. God is in the process of teaching His people that they need to be cleaned up to enter His presence. And it's that filth on the inside that really matters. So there is a holy God and there is an unholy people. And that's why God says in 19:10, go to the people, consecrate them today and tomorrow. They must wash their clothes and be prepared. And again, this outward cleansing is only meant to point towards a greater cleansing within that is needed. And only when they are washed may they climb the mountain. Israel may be saved from Egypt and Pharaoh physically, but this entire picture is beginning to show their need for salvation internally, spiritually. And by the way, a bath won't do that one. Something greater is needed. So watch this. God teaches His people that they must come to Him on His terms. In Exodus 19:12, it says, put boundaries for the people all around the mountain and say, be careful that you don't go up on the mountain or touch its base. Anyone who touches the mountain must be put to death. No hand may touch him. Instead, he will be stoned or shot with arrows and not live, whether animal or human. And when the ram's horn sounds a long blast, they may go up the mountain. And so the Israelites can't just run to the mountain to meet with God. And so Moses came down from the mountain to the people. He consecrated them. They washed their clothes, verse 14. They tossed some quarters into the laundromat washer. And then Moses said in verse 15, be prepared by the third day. It's all about this being prepared to meet with God and to enter His presence. So what happens next? The Lord comes down. He keeps His promise. And Exodus 19:16 says, on the third day, when morning came, there was thunder and lightning and a thick cloud on the mountain and a very loud blast from a ram's horn, so that all the people in the camp shuddered. And God's presence was felt, and it was known, thunder and lightning. And God hides Himself in a thick cloud. You know, God doesn't lower his standard of holiness, but he does cover himself so as not to kill the Israelites. And then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. And Mount Sinai, picture this, was completely enveloped in smoke because the Lord came down on it in fire. And its smoke went up like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain shook violently. As the sound of the ram's horn grew louder and louder, Moses spoke and God answered him in the thunder. And so, with all due respect to those who live in the mountains of eastern and western North Carolina, this was the first reference to the Great Smoky Mountains right here. And by the way, our mountains are a little smoky today too, aren't they? Can you imagine the sights and the sounds of this moment? When God comes down, he gives the permission to the people to come when the ram's horn sounds that long blast, and that's what it does. In verses 16 and 19, there's a whole lot of horn tooting going on. But Moses knows that although the people have been cleaned up externally, that they are still inwardly dirty. And he says in verse 23, "The people cannot come up Mount Sinai. Since you warned us, put a boundary around the mountain and consecrate it." The people were unclean. If our hearts could be x-rayed spiritually so as to be seen, what filth would be seen there? You see, the Bible teaches that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's none of us who are clean. There's none of us who are good. We are all sinners who stand in need of being cleaned up by God. And Moses gets that even though they're cleaned externally, there's this sin below the surface. You know, in my yard right now as we speak, it's interesting. I learned about this as I got back from vacation. I have tree saplings popping up all in my backyard, just everywhere. There hasn't been one before, but they're everywhere now. And right before we went on vacation, early June, there was a line of trees that were cut down behind the fence. Our neighbors cut them down. And can you believe there is this root system under the ground that is now fighting back, trying to live? And it was under the surface that whole time. I didn't know it. I've been mowing my lawn out there. But as soon as those trees came down, all these saplings pop up. And it was an illustration to me of what's right below the surface. What's there all the time. And right below the surface, there is sin. And that sin separates man from God. And that's really what we're dealing with here this morning. And so we come to this fourth question. What is necessary for sinful man to approach a holy God? What is necessary for a sinful man to approach a holy God? And the answer is a mediator is required to bridge the gap between God and man. Exodus 19:20 says, "The Lord came down on Mount Sinai at the top of the mountain, and then the Lord summoned Moses to the top of the mountain, and he went up." I want you to listen to these key phrases. Got your ear? It says, "The Lord came down, the Lord summoned Moses, and he went up." Now, we notice in verse number 21 that the Lord directed Moses, "Go down, warn the people not to break through to see the Lord, otherwise many of them will die." And so it's a reminder that the Israelites cannot be in a relationship with God because of their sin. If they approach on their own or on their own terms, God will destroy them. So what verse 21 says. So to see God in this way is to see him balanced. Some people like to focus on the love of God, and that's it. Some people like to focus on the holiness of God, and that's it. But God is both a loving God and a holy God. And we see that in this moment as well. And so it is God's love that compels him to send his son to fulfill righteousness's demand. And so, now this quote is not my own. I can't take credit for it, but it's good. The bad news is that dirty people can't approach a good God. But the good news is a good God can approach dirty people. Enter Jesus. That's how he does it. And so we have a mediator, one who stands in the middle, who reconciles. And we see that the first mediator here is Moses. Now, follow this pattern that we see here in Exodus 19. In verse 3, Moses went up to God. In verse 7, Moses came back down to the people. In verse 8, Moses went up. In verse 14, Moses came back down. In verse 20, Moses goes up. In verse 25, Moses goes back down. I haven't heard that many up-downs since I was in football in high school. And I was running hills and flat spaces. This is an 80-year-old man plus going up and down the mountain, right? Moses goes up to God. He comes down to the people. Moses is a mediator, but he's not an effective mediator. And I don't mean any disrespect to Moses. But no matter how many times he does up-downs, the people are going to fail to keep the covenant. They fail because of sin. And the people quickly agree to obey in Exodus 19:8, but not very many days later, they're going to be standing worshiping a golden calf. So Moses is not the ultimate mediator. He's not an effective mediator. The mediator needed to stand between God and man is completely different. Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 3. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and his brother John and led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transformed in front of them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as light. And suddenly Moses and Elijah appear before them talking with him. You notice here, his face was shining like the sun, his clothes as white as light. And who's there? Moses is there. And it's reminiscent of Exodus 19 with the cloud and the thunder and the lightning and the smoke. And then old Peter opened his mouth, didn't he? And Peter said, "Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you want, I'll set up 3 shelters here. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." And then the answer comes in Matthew 17:5. While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." And when the disciples heard this, they fell face down. They were terrified. Jesus came up, touched them, and said, "Get up, don't be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. Moses gone, Elijah gone. This scripture just makes it so clear. It's not Moses, it's not Elijah, it's not any other. It is Jesus. And in Exodus 19 fashion, God stripped back all the rest. You know, there was Peter, and he wanted to sing, "Praise the name of Jesus and Moses and Elijah." And God said, "No, it's just praise the name of Jesus." But don't miss this. There's something different about this moment. You know, you think about Exodus 19, the boundaries. Don't come or you'll be destroyed because of sin. And now Jesus comes, and Jesus says, "Come to me." He says, "Do not be afraid." Revelation 21, I heard a loud voice from the throne. "Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and he will live with them, and they will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them and will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more, because the previous things have passed away." What changed? What made all the difference? Jesus made all the difference. What Jesus accomplished on the cross made all the difference. He is our mediator, and through him we are saved from our sins, and we are reconciled with God. He's our mediator. He's our reconciler, and that is the theme of Hebrews 12, which ties together everything that we've talked about. Because Hebrews 12:18 says, "For you have not come to what could be touched, to a blazing fire, to darkness, gloom, and storm, to the blast of a trumpet, and the sound of words. Those who heard it begged that not another word be spoken to them, for they could not bear what was commanded. If even an animal touches the mountain, it must be stoned." The appearance was so terrifying that Moses said, "I am trembling with fear." That's the picture of Exodus 19. Transition. "Instead, you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to myriads of angels, a festive gathering, to the assembly of the firstborn whose names have been written in heaven, to a judge who is God of all, to the spirits of righteous people made perfect. And here it is. And to Jesus, our mediator, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood which says things better than the blood of Abel. We do not approach God like the Israelites in Sinai. No, we approach God through the mediator, Jesus Christ. His blood washes us whiter than snow on the inside. He doesn't say, go to the laundromat, clean up your clothes, go to the laundromat, clean up your life, and then come to me. Jesus says, come to me, don't be afraid, I will clean you up. And as Jesus cleans us up, and as he makes us alive, and as he lifts us up into the very presence of God, our mediator reconciles us, saves us, gives us life. Why? Because he is a promise keeper. And so God brought Israel back to the mountain because that's what he promised to do. The people met with God because they needed to hear from him. This was a define the relationship moment, but there was a problem. The sin of the people separated them from the holiness of God. And Israel would continually fail moving forward to keep the conditions of the covenant. And it was a reminder of a need for a Savior, a perfect mediator. Fast forward, enter Jesus, who also went up a mountain. Moses went up Mount Sinai. Jesus climbed Mount Zion. He climbed Mount Calvary. And there Jesus shed his precious blood as the perfect sacrifice for sin. And then 3 days later, being raised from the dead, Jesus is our great high priest, our great mediator between man and God. Let me close out with some scripture this morning from Hebrews 4, 14 through 16. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in time of need. Through Jesus, we have access to the throne of grace anytime. We can hear from God anytime. We have access to God anytime. We can approach the throne of grace because Jesus came to us even when we were dirty. And if you're in Christ today, if you've trusted him as your Savior, he has cleaned you up. Some of you may know the name Kyle Idleman. He's an author of a book called Not a Fan. And in that book, he actually writes about DTR, about defining the relationship. And so, just the last word this morning, I want to read you a quote from that book. He writes this: it may seem that there are many followers of Jesus, but if they were honestly to define the relationship they have with him, I am not sure it would be accurate to describe them as followers. It seems to me that there is a more suitable word to describe them. They are not followers of Jesus, they are fans of Jesus. Here is the most basic definition of fan in the dictionary: an enthusiastic admirer. And I think Jesus has a lot of fans these days. Fans who cheer for him when things are going well, but who walk away when it's a difficult season. Fans who sit safely in the stands cheering, but they know nothing of sacrifice and pain of the field. Fans of Jesus who know all about him, but they don't know him. But Jesus was never interested in having fans. When he defines what kind of relationship he wants, enthusiastic admirer isn't an option. And my concern is that many of our churches in America have gone from being sanctuaries to becoming stadiums. And every week, all of the fans come to the stadium where they cheer for Jesus but have no interest in truly following him. The biggest threat to the church today is fans who call themselves Christians but aren't actually interested in following Christ. They want to be close enough to Jesus to get all the benefits, but not so close that it requires anything from them. Let's honestly and biblically define the relationship. Are you a follower of Jesus, or are you really just a fan? Jesus said, come to me. He said, anyone who desires to follow me, take up your cross. Take up your cross and follow me. And so I'm just going to let that question hang in the air this morning. Are you a fan or are you a follower? Has there been a time in your life when you've given your life to Jesus and said, Jesus, I want to follow you. I want to be your disciple. I want to give you my life. I want to surrender all to you. Because I'm telling you, if you'll surrender to Jesus, he'll clean you up. He'll save you. He'll set you free. But there's no other way. And in a day where we want to come to God in our own terms, Jesus is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. There's no other way to the Father but through him. Are you a follower? Let's pray. Lord, thank you that you are a promise keeper. Thank you that when we read your word and when we see what it says about who you are and what you're going to do, that we don't have to doubt. That all throughout Scripture, we've seen time and time again where you've spoken and you've done exactly what you'd say you're going to do. Lord, we long for your return to make all things right in this world that we live in. But Lord, in this day and in this moment, your call is to come and follow. And I pray today that for those of us who know you, Lord, that we would confess sin that you convict us of and that we would turn from it to you in repentance, knowing that you're faithful to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And Lord, I pray today for one who may be here today who's never made that decision to follow you, maybe have had some religion, maybe some church membership, maybe have heard a lot of sermons, but never made the decision to follow you. I pray that today they would cry out to you and be saved. Lord, thank you. And I pray that as we sing, that we would truly stand on your promises. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing this morning. Thank you so much for being here today. We're going to head out to Sunday school here in just a moment. Teachers, if you didn't get the text, we'd love to have some videos this morning to send Terry of people saying hello, praying for you. So that would be great. Let me know if you need any help with that. The text also has a phone number to send those to. Scott's going to come pray. Let me transition this prayer. It's hot, right? I mean, it's been so hot. And I don't know about what you see in your world, but it would seem that people are just a little bit on edge these days. People are just a little bit, Justin used the word hangry last week. That's hungry, angry. I think we're hot and angry. So listen, I'm not talking about you, of course, but let me just encourage you today. If you find the temperature rising internally, remember that song. Let's stand on the promises of God. This world's not our home. We're just passing through, and God's got it. Amen? Scott, close us in prayer.
Lord God, we're just so thankful for this message today. We follow you, Lord, daily, and we ask that in our hearts that we follow you closely and not just cursory, but make you the most important things in our life. And if we approach each other as we approach others, help us to share the truth of Jesus Christ. And we know you are the great promise keeper, Father, and the rescuer of not only Israel, but our own souls. And we thank you for your son, Jesus, who died for us on the cross. And be with us this week, Father, and be with those who are ailing and sick and going through difficult times. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.